you're purchasing a WeatherTight warranty through Sheffield Metals, there's a very specific set of procedures and requirements that's going to be expected of you by the Sheffield Metals technical department. Make sure you watch this video to learn about every step of the process. What's up, guys? Welcome to the Metal Roofing Channel. I'm Thad Barnett. Subscribe if you're new. We release metal roofing and metal construction content every Monday and Wednesday. Today, we are learning about WeatherTight warranties, what you can expect from the procedures and requirements during the process. Remember, these are for commercial projects only. You can only get a WeatherTight warranty through Sheffield Metals on a commercial project. Today, we have Dave Stubbs, the Assistant Technical Director, with us, and he's going to explain the procedures and requirements of a Sheffield Metals WeatherTight warranty.
Here is the first page of the WeatherTight warranty. We have to make sure that the panel itself or the profile is appropriate for the application, and it has to meet, you know, the technical standards and the performance standards of the project. So that's key. There's some panel profiles that we don't support in the WeatherTight warranty. The fastener flange is not an approved WeatherTight warranty panel or profile. And a big one is 7/16 OSB. That's not an acceptable substrate for attachment for the performance level that we support for the duration of the warranty. We require a minimal quality underlayment. 90% of the time, we're going to require a synthetic peel and stick underlayment. And we support Sharkskin Ultra SA for most of our projects. For me, in a professional standpoint, there's really no point in having mechanical fasteners or any sort of nail attaching the underlayment. A lot of times those will show through, and then we start getting into some aesthetic things. So we prefer to have a good synthetic underlayment, a peel and stick, and that's really going to support our WeatherTight warranty criteria, and it's really best practices throughout the industry. And we also want to dictate all the components that go into the WeatherTight warranty assembly. So if something doesn't get purchased from us, well, it needs to be approved. And that's critical to knowing what goes into the assembly for the duration, whether it's, you know, we do 5 year to 35 years. So it's we really need to know what's going in and make sure that it's going to last what I consider a 50-year roof. We also support triangle fasteners, and they're fasteners that are high quality, and we know how they perform. That's what we use in most of our testing when we go down to the lab and make sure that things perform. Also, our sealant. Not a lot of sealant is used on the exterior. Most of it's in the laps, but we want to use one sealant. And most of the time, we're using NovaFlex metal roof sealant. Great stuff, great performer. Or APS 500, basically the same formula, just a different branding technique. Our WeatherTight warranties are always going to be installed per UL 90, and that's just the performance level and where we need to be to sustain the WeatherTight warranty for the duration of the warranty. And then some of the other details are, you know, penetrations. If they're too large for a pipe boot, we're going to have a pre-manufactured curb. And this is an area that I kind of get a lot of pushback, or I can just say we get a lot of pushback in the durability and the duration of the warranties. A pre-manufactured curb and its performance level is really, really important. Panels don't leak. It's always the changes, right? It's a change of dimension or the change of plane, whether it's a transition, a curb, a pipe penetration, something of that nature. So the pre-manufactured curbs that we get from RPI Roof Products Incorporated are fully welded. They're 050 aluminum, and they are tested to a performance level, and they're warrantable. If you have a chance, check out that video, the pre-manufactured curb video. That's a good one. It's a pretty easy process, and it's a really good video. So the other documents that we're going to need are, we're going to need a roof plan, we're going to need elevations, and we're going to need, as I mentioned before, the specifications are always good. And with the roof plan, so many times now, they're not putting everything in the roof plan as we used to see it. So now we've kind of got to ask for all the roof plans, because so many times there's the MEP roof plan, which is the mechanical, electrical, and plumbing roof plan. And that generally is the one that shows all the penetrations, and that's where the curbs and pipe penetrations come into play. With the application, the roof plan, the specifications, and the elevations, That's really the component for the larger portion of the submittal package. The other large part is the submittal of details. Generally, I will share whatever profile is discussed. Let's just say it's going to be the 1¾-inch, the SMI 1.75 snap lock. If that's the panel profile that's subject to the weather site warranty, I will generally give them the general standard details that Sheffield Metals has. I would say 85%, 90% of the time, those are all the details necessary to install on the majority of roofs. If other specific details are needed, the installer needs to submit those, and then we approve those. So once we get all the details, I go through and review them, approve them, and then before the project gets handed off to our inspector and the field team, we go through it once again to make sure that we get more than one set of eyes on the approved installation details. And those are reviewed with the roof plan in mind, the elevations, make sure everything makes sense, and make sure that all the details are covered. If there's any holes or gaps, some things need to be field generated. We don't know what we're getting into until we get there. And that's fine too. We're pretty fleet of foot as far as approving details and getting details. We try to help out. So many times we end up doing some of the details because they're too difficult or they're not sure what we need. But we really like to see the involvement of the contracted installer to get the details to us and see where their state of mind is and what they're thinking they can install. And then we can kind of dictate how it gets installed from there. Once the submitted details are approved, they're stamped, they're distributed, and we require all of those things to be on site at all times. Those documents are really important. Most of the time it's for reference, and it's hard to hold the installers accountable to details if they're not on site, if they're not approved. And then we can say, well, you know, why didn't you install it as the approved installation details dictate? And that kind of puts the onus on them. So that's kind of the approach that we take. We try to get the approved installation details signed and stamped and off to the contractor. And then that project is assigned to an inspector. At that point, that becomes his project. So then we start getting into inspections and the inspection process. And during the project installation, inspections are to be scheduled 3 weeks in advance. And look, my team and myself, we understand it's construction. We really like to have 3 weeks in advance. Some projects don't last 3 weeks. And in any of these cases, whether you can get us 3 weeks or can't get 3 weeks, we ask that you provide pictures to us in a timely manner. And the timely manner thing is super important because the picture that's taken on Monday, if it doesn't get distributed until Friday, there's a lot of roofing that can take place between Monday and Friday. But when we get to the project for inspection, we require the contractor have, you know, all the safety equipment set up prior to us getting there, which is critical because if we get there and they've got to set it up, that's just time we can't get back. So we require that all the harnesses and all the ropes and anchor points are already set up so we can, you know, make our way around the roof and make sure it's installed, you know, the way we want per the installation details. All the fall protection needs to be supplied to us because we're traveling and making sure that the projects are done right. So respectfully, please have that stuff set up before we get there. Prior to the inspection, we go through. So once I get all the approved installation details approved, stamped, and distributed, and before we get the inspection process done, I have an online meeting. So we do a Zoom meeting, go through the details, get the appropriate parties, the installers, the supervision, and hopefully the project manager wants to be involved so he knows what's to be expected. And all those things are divulged in an online meeting in Zoom. Questions can be asked, that line of communication gets opened up, and we can have fully candid conversations about who, what, and why. And maybe, hey, where do you think about starting? And we can kind of get a feel on how the project is going to go and hopefully get started on the right foot. Our procedures say our in-progress roof inspection should be about 50%. We tend to heat on the side of caution, probably get there about 20 to 30%, just because we don't want too much roofing or too much material installed before we get there in case there's a problem. It also, when we do our review, we kind of get a better feeling how difficult, how complex the project is. so that we can kind of get there. If they're starting on a really easy section, maybe we can get there a little later. If they're starting on a really hard section, we might need to get there a little earlier. So we can identify those problems or concerns. They're not a problem yet. They're more concerns early on in the project when we're doing our online meeting and prior to the in-progress inspection. And then when the project is done or very, very close to it, we'll do a final inspection. With the in-progress inspection, you also get a report. Along with the final inspection, you also get a final inspection report. And like I said, it comes with pictures, identifying problems, and also remedies. Remedies are sometimes harder than others. And sometimes the remedy is take it off and try again, which is never a good conversation. But we have to make sure that the panels and the entire assembly is installed to be a warrantable condition. And that's where we want to be. So in the quote form, along with the procedures, we've also incorporated the closeout portion of it. So after the project is completed, we list all the documents that are required. So Sheffield Technical Part will send out, distribute the WeatherTight warranty documents, the invoice for WeatherTight warranty, and we also include the procedures once again, just to make sure that they're all in one package. And we call that the closeout package. And then after you receive the paperwork, those need to be signed. We have a couple different renditions of how to get to that point. We can either do it snail mail or mail. We've definitely done it that way. We're still doing it that way, but we also incorporate the electronic way, which is just email and electronic signatures, which is, you know, vastly improved the speed in which we can close out projects. But we always want to get, you know, paperwork signed, paid, and then I sign all the warranties.
Thanks, Dave. Really appreciate it. And make sure you comment down below if you have any questions. Check out SheffieldMetals.com to learn more about the technical department and your WeatherTight warranty options for commercial building projects. Thanks for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe here. And as always, I'm Thad Barnett. We'll catch you next time.